الحمد لله نحمده سبحانه ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهد الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله وصفوته من خلقه وحبيبه، قد بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وكشف الغمة وجاهد في سبيل دينه حتى أتاه اليقين. فاللهم اجزه عنا وعن والدينا وعن الإسلام والمسلمين خير ما جازيت به نبيا عن قومه ورسولا عن أمته. اللهم أحينا على سنته وأمتنا على ملته، واحشرنا تحت لوائه وأوردنا حوضه، واسقنا من يده الشريفة شربة هنيئة لا نظمأ بعدها أبدا. أما بعد، we are continuing to explore how much the Quran gives us of the past, the present and the future, and how what the Quran tells us is very relevant, not only relevant but much needed for us to see our way forward as a community, as an ummah, as a nation, as a society. The view that you get from the Quran is the most accurate and the most truthful one. Any competing view that tries to taint or paint or format your worldview is nothing but deception. Anything that goes through human hands is subject to corruption. It is subject to corruption unless Allah preserves it to be what He wants it to be. And we spoke about this last time. Last time we stopped at the ayah number 12 from Surah Al-Isra. وَجَعَلْنَا اللَّيْلَ وَالنَّهَارَ آيَتَيْنِ فَمَحَوْنَا آيَةَ اللَّيْلِ وَجَعَلْنَا آيَةَ النَّهَارِ مُبْصِرَةً لِتَبْتَغُوا فَضْلًا مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ. This ayah has a relevant two questions that the Quran asks in another place. The Quran asks and says, قُلْ أَرَأَيْتُمْ إِنْ جَعَلَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكُمُ اللَّيْلَ سَرْمَدًا إِلَى يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ مَنْ إِلَهٌ غَيْرُ اللَّهِ يَأْتِيكُمْ بِضِيَاءٍ. If Allah were to make the night the permanent standing time that you live through, which is darkness, you don't see enough, you cannot function, you cannot earn your living, then the question is, who was going to give you light other than Him? The answer is obvious. Then it asks the other question, قُلْ أَرَأَيْتُمْ إِنْ جَعَلَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكُمُ النَّهَارَ سَرْمَدًا إِلَى يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ. If Allah were to make the daylight time the only permanent standing time you have, فَمَنْ يَأْتِيكُمْ غَيْرُ اللَّهِ فَمَنْ غَيْرُ اللَّهِ يَأْتِيكُمْ بِلَيْلٍ تَسْكُنُونَ فِيهِ. Who was going to provide you with a calm night time so that you can rest? So it is obvious that not only al-layl wal-nahar are created for a purpose, but for a functional purpose. So it is not just for our wishing or any, it is our bodies need functioning time and it needs resting time. We spoke about this also last time. And then Allah says, وَلِتَعْلَمُوا عَدَدَ السِّنِينَ وَالْحِسَابِ, so that you may know the numbers of years. And the numbers in general would help you calculate. So accounting for how many days, how many weeks, how many months, how many years requires that those have marks. So what marks the beginning of the day? It is marked by the beginning of the night. And that's why you see always, whenever there is an ayah that talks about the night and the day, it starts with the night first, then the day after. So Muslims and other communities they understand, those who go by the lunar calendar, their day starts with the night. That's why we call it Laylatul Sabt, the night of Saturday, which comes when? It comes on Friday at Maghrib time. So the day starts with the night ushering in, then sun becomes a sign for the day. وَجَعَلْنَا الشَّمْسَ عَلَيْهِ دَلِيلًا. We have made the sun a mark for the beginning of the day, which means the active part of the day. Because the night is also part of the entirety of the day, but we distinguish between the two by saying the night time and the day light time. So the day light is marked by the sun, and the night is marked by the darkness. This is obvious. Why am I explaining this? But it is also to point the fact that so many people today are still stuck with the literal meaning of the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ talking about moon sighting as a mark for the beginning of the lunar month. And moon sighting is a mark, that is definitely true. But the hadith also extends to say, نحن أمة أمية. We are an unlettered ummah. Our community in the Jazirat al-Arab in general is unlettered, which means uneducated in all sciences and stuff like this. So as an excuse, the Prophet ﷺ tells us, الشهر هكذا وهكذا. So it's either 30 days or 29 days. And he's marking by his hand to lead his community. This is what 30 is, this is what 29 is. So when you read this in the Quran, wherever this ayah is mentioned, whether here or in Surah Yunus or in Surah Al-Qasas, you will find that the day and the night are marks to help us calculate. Calculate what? عدد السنين والحساب. And as we mentioned, السنه is the totality of the number of months. And the Quran told us, إِنَّ عِدَّةَ الشُّهُورِ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ 12 شَهْرًا يَوْمَ خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. The number of months, according to Allah, when He created the heavens and the earth, is 12 months every year. So those who make it 19 or 27 or whatever number of days or anything or nights or months, it is their calculations, but for Allah, the year is 12 months and the month is 29 days or 30 days. وَكُلَّ شَيْءٍ فَصَّلْنَاهُ تَفْصِيلًا. And in this remark, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us that everything in life seems to be connected to the day and the night. Everything has a turnout, everything has a beginning, everything has an end. Everything has a beginning. And anything that has a beginning, it does have an end. And everything rotates, like the earth is rotating around the sun, orbiting around the sun, and the moon is orbiting around the earth, and this is what forms the year calculation and the month calculation. Likewise, everything in life rotates. So you will see that the Quran, for example, talks to us about وَتِلْكَ الْأَيَّامُ نُدَاوِلُهَا بَيْنَ النَّاسِ. So power doesn't stand forever, weakness doesn't stand forever, disease doesn't stay forever, death doesn't take everybody all at once, birth, not everybody is born all at the same time. So everything takes a space and a time. And these are the two major dimensions through which we live. So we need to understand the space in which we live and the time in which we live and the events through which we are going. This is very, very important ayah that points us to these facts so that we are more able to handle ourselves and our challenges as life goes on. Then on the Day of Judgment, next ayah, number 13, وَكُلَّ إِنسَانٍ أَلْزَمْنَاهُ طَائِرَهُ فِي عُنُقِهِ. Now, this ayah is talking about humans in general. The previous ayat in the beginning of the surah, as you may remember, was talking about the prospect of the future of the children of Israel when the time of the revelation was going on. It gives them a timeline, not by time, but by events. So it tells them their future. But now it is telling us every human being will have his amen attached to his own neck. Why does the Quran use the word ta'irahu in place of the word amen? I hope you know what the word amen is. Amen is what makes you feel optimistic or pessimistic. It's called ta'irahu. Why it's called ta'ir, which is a bird? It is because the Arabs used to use birds to determine if something should lead them to hope and optimism or hopelessness and pessimism. How do they do this? If they want to travel, for example, they would send a couple of birds in the sky to fly. And as they send them, they watch. If the birds go right, then they are optimistic and they are traveling. If the birds go left, then they are pessimistic and it's a bad luck, bad omen, and then they do not travel. And this is prohibited in Islam. This is prohibited in Islam. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, everybody, if you want to talk about omen, look for the omen that you can manufacture with your own hands. This is the luck that you make. This is not something random. Fate is not random. Our final place in the hereafter is not random. It is not haphazard. It is not out of our choice. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا قُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ وَأَهْلِيكُمْ نَارًا. O you who believe, protect yourselves and your children and your family from hellfire. In other words, the Quran is giving us the key of our own salvation in our own hands, by our own choices, decisions, and actions. أَلْزَمْنَاهُ طَائِرَهُ فِي عُنُقِهِ. It is stuck, your omen, your luck, is stuck in your neck. In the form of what? Your book of deeds will be hanging from your neck and it will be open. It will be open. كِتَابًا يَلْقَاهُ مَنْشُورًا. We will present them on the Day of Judgment with a book that they will find open. It will be seen by you. And if you're happy, you will say, هَاءُ مُقْرَأُ كِتَابِيَّ إِنِّي ظَنَنْتُ أَنِّي مُلَاقٍ حِسَابِيَّ. It will be a happy moment. May Allah make it a happy moment for all the Muslims, Ya Rabbi. So, and if it were not a happy finding, then the person would say, يَا لَيْتَنِي لَمْ أُوتَ كِتَابِيَّ يَا لَيْتَهَا كَانَتِ الْقَاضِيَّ. And he will lament that his money is gone, his power is gone, there is nothing left for him except what he has done of deeds. So the Quran is an amazing book. It keeps taking you to connect you between what you have of choices and what fate those choices lead to. And it tells you, you have the power to craft your way into the hereafter. You have the power to craft your way, your place in the hereafter is in your hand. It is very empowering. It gives you the control. Of course, like everything else, Allah gives us money, but the ultimate owner is Allah. Allah provides us with risk, right? But the ultimate decision as far as risk is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we work our best and leave for Allah all the rest. And Allah is merciful. He is not giving us unpredictable reaction from His side. He is telling us, فَأَمَّا مَنْ أَعْطَى وَاتَّقَى وَصَدَّقَ بِالْحُسْنَى فَسَنُيَسِّرُهُ لِلْيُسْرَى وَأَمَّا مَنْ بَخِلَ وَاسْتَغْنَى وَكَذَّبَ بِالْحُسْنَى فَسَنُيَسِّرُهُ لِلْعُسْرَى. So He's telling you, you have the choice. We will give you the push wherever you want to go. If you want to go to paradise, show us the work and we will help give you the push to where you want to go. Your actions will determine what push you get from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah saying, yes, the ultimate decision is mine, I am in control, but Allah is just. حَكَمٌ عَدْلٌ وَلَا يَظْلِمُ رَبُّكَ أَحَدًا. He never wrongs anyone. So He gives you as much as you ask. He gives you as much as you ask for the hereafter. But for this life, He gives you as much as He had determined and designated for you. Subhanallah. Then on that day, ayah number 14, اقرأ كتابك. Read your own book. This is what your hands have earned. This is what you have done. Read your own deeds. And as I mentioned, when we read it, we either become very happy and optimistic, we know our fate, or we know it is like when you receive the exam paper back from the teacher and it's marked in a way all red writing, that is not good news, right? But if it is a good remark that you read on the paper, then you know you've passed at least. So here it says, اقرأ كتابك, read your book. كفى بنفسك اليوم عليك حسيبا. Enough of an accountant against yourself is yourself. So a nafs that we have served for life, we pampered ourselves, right? We spoiled ourselves. We wanted to get all what ourselves tell us we need. And we sold our principles, our ideals, our beliefs at times, just to give ourselves what it's asking us for. But then, on the day of judgment, يَوْمَ تَأْتِي كُلُّ نَفْسٍ تُجَادِلُ عَنْ نَفْسِهَا. Every soul will be trying to defend itself. But where and at what time? So Allah gives us chances to repent and to correct in this life before these moments come in. So, ayah number 15, مَنْ اِهْتَدَى فَإِنَّمَا يَهْتَدِي لِنَفْسِهِ. He who is guided, he who is following the guidance Allah has given them, فَقَدْ اِهْتَدَى لِنَفْسِهِ. He is guided for his own best interest. When you follow the guidance of Allah, it is your interest. It is your fate. It is your end on the day of judgment. وَمَنْ ضَلَّ فَإِنَّمَا يَضِلُّ عَلَيْهَا. And he who is gone astray, he is gone astray against his own best interest. So when we make a decision, we should not look for what is pleasant, what is nice, what feels good, what is fun now. Look for what is pleasant later on. Later on the day of judgment, it will not be just nice and difficult. It will be paradise or, wal'ayadu billah, hellfire. May Allah protect us all from hellfire. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here is telling us, if you're guided, it's your choice. You remember the ayah that we went over in the beginning, in ahsantum ahsantum li anfusikum. If you do good, you're doing good, for your own interest. Wa in asa'tum falaha. If you do bad, you're doing bad to yourself. You are hurting yourself. You are hurting your interest. So the word you utter, the attitude that you have, the way you talk to people, the way you treat people, the way you use the gifts and bounties of Allah in your life, all of this will be written in your book. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make our book a reason for hopeful approach, inshallah, into paradise. And then, وَلَا تَزِرُ وَازِرَةٌ وِزْرَ أُخْرَى. Nobody, no soul, No sinful soul will carry the sin of another soul. So in this life, we almost always use the excuse that he did this. That is his sin. Don't start your own. Because what he does is his deed. But what you do after is your choice. There's always a choice to do better, to do worse, or to do the same. The Quran says, answer and respond, not in kind, but in a better way. ادفع بالتي هي أحسن. So the child's excuse of he did it first or he started it doesn't work on the day of judgment. It does not. Every soul will carry its own sins. It doesn't mean that if I am in a position that people follow my example, that I'm not going to carry their sin if I mislead them. So if you are in a position of leadership, like a parent, for example, or a neighbor leader in the neighborhood, and your example is bad example, people who follow you will carry the sin of their choices. But you also will have a share of their sins. لِيَحْمِلُوا أَوْزَارَهُمْ وَأَوْزَارَ الَّذِينَ يُضِلُّونَهُمْ بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ. When you are leading a community, and the community, even in your opinion, is not well informed, it is your responsibility to inform them. But don't lead a blind community. قُلْ هَذِهِ سَبِيلِي أَدْعُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ عَلَى بَصِيرَةٍ أَنَا وَمَنِ اتَّبَعَنِي. Say, O Muhammad, this is my path to Allah. I call unto Allah, me, myself, and those who follow me on a clear view, clear vision. So it is not a good leadership that would lead people into a place that is not good for their interest. It is not. And this applies to the family, the individual leading yourself, and the family, and the community, and the society, and the nation, and the world. So when we say world leaders, those guys are going to be held to account also. Don't forget, it's not a title of honor to be a world leader. It is a huge responsibility. So if any person is leading even two people behind him, or one person behind him, he better be ready to be responsible. Because those followers are going to attack you on the day of judgment for misleading them. It is very important. And on the part of the follower, you should never follow anyone blindly, no matter how much you trust them. Don't follow blindly. Follow on a clear view. It is like, for example, and I'm giving this to just illustrate and simplify the issue. If you're following somebody who's driving to New York, and your purpose is to go to New York, and he told you he is going to New York, he has gone to New York several times, right? And all the way you're seeing signs of 95 North, 95 North, right? And you're seeing signs, New York, 176 miles, New York, 100 miles, New York, 50 miles. But then if those signs start to disappear completely, or if it starts to say 95 South, even though you're following him, but you're not gonna continue to follow somebody in the wrong direction. That's why it is instituted in Islam between leadership and community and society and nation, that shura process. That shura process clarifies. So from time to time, you call him, are you sure we are on the right track? Are you sure we are in the right direction? And once you see a sign, you call your leader and tell him, I am seeing 95 South, something is wrong. But to follow blindly is not Islam. To follow with open eyes, open hearts, and open mind, so that you are a check on your leader, and your leader is entrusted to only lead you in the right direction. And here it comes ولا تزر وازرة وزر أخرى. And then it comes the issue of leadership. وما كنا معذبين حتى نبعث رسولا. So between you and your leader is a messenger and guidance and a book. Those should be the guiding principles for your following. So you follow them as long as they are following the Prophet ﷺ. You follow them as long as they are following Islam, the Quran, as long as they are following the guidance of the Quran. This is how we save ourselves. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all from hellfire. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وصفوته من خلقه وحبيبه. Brothers and sisters, so many issues whenever we talk about the Quran, because the Quran is a book for life. It is not just for a structure, it's not just for a limited objective. It is not just for this life, it is for this life as a bridge towards the hereafter. So it extends beyond our life. As it talks about to us about what is good for this life, it talks to us about what is good for the hereafter, and it tells us how to bridge, how to use this life to build the credit in the hereafter without losing on what you want to enjoy in this life. قل من حرم زينة الله التي أخرج لعباده والطيبات من الرزق قل هي للذين آمنوا في الحياة الدنيا خالصة يوم القيامة. Say, who is it who would prohibit the good things that Allah has put forth in this life for everybody? It's not prohibited, but in the hereafter it is exclusively for those who believed in Allah and followed his guidance. خَالِصَةً يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. It is exclusively gonna be given to those who believe and do righteous deeds. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us do righteous deeds all the time. اللهم اهدنا في من هديت وعافنا في من عافيت وتولنا في من توليت وقنا واصرف عنا شر ما قضيت. اللهم اقسم لنا من خشيتك ما تحول به بيننا وبين معصيتك ومن طاعتك ما تبلغنا به جنتك ومن اليقين ما تهون به علينا مصائب الدنيا. ومتعنا اللهم بأسماعنا وأبصارنا وقوتنا ما أحييتنا واجعله الوارث منا واجعل ثأرنا على من ظلمنا ولا تجعل مصيبتنا في ديننا ولا تجعل الدنيا أكبر همنا ولا مبلغ علمنا ولا إلى النار مصيرنا. وإذا أردت بقومنا فتنة فنجنا منها يا مولانا غير خزايا ولا مفتونين ولا مبدلين ولا مغيرين. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم فستذكرون ما أقول لكم وأفوض أمري إلى الله إن الله بصير بالعباد. وأقم الصلاة.